After that, the Lord spoke with me about the rapture of the dead, 25 days after that visitation, on the 26th of November. I sent this message across the globe to all the preachers you see on TBN and Daystar, any Christian TVs. He told me in a dream, want them to know that I am soon coming for the church. First of all, they were so surprised that this time God spoke from Africa. That really surprised them. But I think we ought to see the humble nature of our God. Now, after that, he spoke to me in a vision, and I saw how the dead will rapture the dead Christians on the day of the wedding of the Lamb. And in that vision, the Lord lifted me up in the sky, and then I saw the earth and a lot of turbulence on the surface, dust and soil jumping in that vision. And then after that, I saw people in their glorious bodies coming out of their tombs. And they were caught up in the glory of the Lord, and heaven opened and they entered. What is the message of the University of Nairobi? Today's the USIU Catholic University, Kenyatta University, Jomo Kenyatta University, all the universities including KMTC from Pika and everywhere. What is the message to you in that visitation? Write it down, the book of Daniel chapter 12. I say there is nothing God speaks that you don't find in the Bible. I thank God he sent me. Every country the Lord has sent me to, and we are both in South America, we are living tomorrow in Southern Africa, we are both in Europe, Asia, everywhere. There has been a common problem that the church has not bothered to tally the word of God with the Bible. The Bible is the mirror God gave us. When you take the Bible as a student and look at your life through the Bible, you are able to see if there are some stains and remove them. Hallelujah. But in Daniel chapter 12, Daniel saw the same vision. And in verse 1, he talks about the great distress that will consume the nations of the earth, as has not happened since the creation of the nations until then, which is now. Listen to me, the university community. Daniel was an end-time prophet. He saw the things of this moment, this end time, from then. And in verse 2, after the distress, he says that multitudes who sleep in the dust of the earth will awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting judgment, damnation, contempt. Hallelujah. But before you get to verse 2, Daniel talks of, but my people, everyone whose name will be found written in the book, will be delivered. Let me stop there. Listen to this. I saw another vision of God last year on August 19th, 2008, and we had a big meeting in Nakuru. We could not fit in the stadium, so we went to the Nakuru Girls High School grounds, because it was more than 1 million people. And on the 24th August 2008, last year, I stood before that meeting after the vision of 19th August, and I said, I have seen the black horse released from the throne of God. And I said, that means there is a global economic crisis coming to the earth. I say the global famine is coming to the earth, because we go to work to bring bread on the table. People go to work to bring bread on the table.
19th of August August 2008.
In the mighty visitation of the Lord. He showed me the black horse that came from heaven and ran all over. And the black horse represents the global famine. He spoke with me about the global famine. Time is over. Repent and prepare the way for the kingdom of God is near.
Why did I say so? And when we were doing a revival in Canada, just barely 2 months from that prophecy, in October, all the global financial markets for sure crashed until today. Until today, the banks, the Western economies, they are trying to resuscitate them. They cannot. It was fulfilled rapidly. What is the meaning of that, precious people? Why did I prophesy global economic crisis coming to the earth, financial meltdown? Why is it that it happened so sharp? Because it is in Revelation chapter 6, verse 5 to verse 7. So you may understand what the Lord is saying. When Daniel said in Daniel 12, that there would be a great distress in these days, it includes the financial crisis that you see consuming the earth right now. The famine that is consuming the nations of the earth right now. And you are so precious a people that you cannot look at these things as just another news item. These were meant to be spiritual landmarks. That when you precious university students who are so blessed and honored to be sitting here, when you will now see them in your news, you say, oh, the Bible said these would be the signs that the Messiah is about to come. It takes away nothing from you precious people, but it adds value to you. Because now you can prepare for the coming of the Lord. So you can win here, win in heaven. And the financial market crashed. But what amazes me in Daniel chapter 12 is that Daniel saw those who were resurrected from the grave for rapture, two types of people. First of all, Daniel saw those who are wise. In Daniel chapter 12 verse 2, we are reading now. Those who are wise, he said, they were shining like the brightness of the heavens. But he says, those who led many to the righteousness of God, they were shining even brighter like the stars. You know that heaven is bright, but when there is a star, it shoots out. What is the message to our precious students in the universities and professors? Listen very carefully now. This is the message. Number one, if it means that those who are wise are the ones that enter heaven, that means time has come for our universities, for the university communities, to now go back into wisdom. To now walk in wisdom. To now turn to the fear of the Lord. Because the fear of the Lord is wisdom. And yes, God is justified to send me here. Because you would ask, why the violence I saw? Because of the immorality, and name it. Number two, shine even brighter on that day. That means he has sent me here to announce to you that time has now come for the university to see you. For the Christians in the university to lead people to the righteousness of Jesus. To lead people to the Jesus of Nazareth. Many of them come as first years, as freshers, and they depend on you. You want to mentor them. But how will you mentor them? Where will you take them? God is saying, please lead them to the righteousness of God, that you may have a reward in heaven and shine like a star. Hallelujah. Make sure you preach to them Jesus. Don't preach Jesus for some other reasons. Don't tell them if you receive Jesus, he will give you ABCD. That is all right. The Lord promises to supply for you. In fact, that's one of the things I'm going to handle with you today. He promises that you may not be anxious. He says he knows that everybody, even the pagans, need these things. How about you who are his children? But first of all, the fear of the Lord. Now you as Christians in more university listening by radio. You as Christians in Egerton University listening by radio. Baraton, Masinde Muliro, and all the universities assembled here. That means from today on, you must reach somebody with the good news of Jesus. Lead them to salvation and follow up with them. Teach them the word. Help them with the word, that they may grow and reach where you are reaching now. But how can you preach righteousness if you're not walking it? That means from today on, your lives have to change. You have to walk in righteousness. I want to jump to the next. I'm just rushing through. These are very comprehensive messages, but I'm just jumping through. After that, precious people, on the 3rd of May, the year 2007, at 5:38 a.m., I saw the vision of the Lord again, where he opened heaven and he lowered a golden clock in the sky. And that clock was 1 minute to midnight. So what is the message to you precious people here? Just write down, because you read them at home. The message is this. Jesus himself talks of the midnight hour. He says he himself will come in the midnight hour. That means the midnight hour is near. What is the next message, precious people? We all know that every time it is 1 minute to midnight, that means the old day is gone and the new day has arrived. I have come to university. I am speaking from the University of Nairobi at the graduation square to tell you, precious people, that the old day, when there was acceptance in sexual sin, the old day where you were Christians and yet you lied on the phones, the old day when you were a Christian student, a girl, and you were in love with a man who is not born again in the university, the old day when the lecturers were now in love with the girls to give them higher grades, the old day when universities were known for abortions and the fetuses are being thrown everywhere, the old day when the young men drank and were drunk and raped girls in the university, tonight. I have come to University of Nairobi to announce that the new day has arrived for this institution. And in the new day, it is the Christians that will shine. Hallelujah! Yeah. I believe in the professors. They will look at the Christian students and they will ask other students, can you be like this one? The new day has arrived. And our way into the new day is repentance and turning away from sin. Returning to holiness. Universities will now be centers of holiness. Even the professors. The new day has come. Now you cannot solicit for sexual favor from students. That if you give me this, I'll give you good grades. That is over. Hallelujah. Let us wear for the new day. Lest we are found naked. The Bible says in Revelation 16:15, behold, I come like a thief, and blessed is he who stays awake and keeps his clothes with himself, that he may not go naked and be shamefully exposed. Hallelujah. What a precious institution you are, that you may not go naked. Look, now you are sitting at the institution of learning, the highest in the land. And now you are also being admitted into the highest kingdom, the kingdom of God. You are a double winner. I want to do this, precious people. After that, the Lord spoke with me again. And that is the vision of the black horse that I shared on the 19th of August. And it's a privilege that even we are sharing this year, because right now, tremendous all over the globe. I told you, we just came back last week for a big meeting in France, and tomorrow we are leaving for Southern America, Southern Africa here. South America is happening everywhere. It is such a privilege to sit with Nairobi and share this to them. Because at times you wonder, people out are preparing. How about Nairobi? Listen to me, precious people. In that vision of the black horse, when I first prophesied the coming of the global economic crisis, and in less than 2 months it happened, until today it's happening to the globe. By the way, that's the biggest prophecy I've ever given that has touched every nation of the globe. You will not understand the message God is bringing to you, universities, in that vision, except that when you are reading Revelation chapter 6, verses 1 all the way down, on the breaking of the seal, which means the timeline for the coming of the Messiah. But when you read verse 7 of Revelation chapter 6, is when you understand what this revelation is. Verse 7 says that the next time a horse is released from heaven, which means the seal is broken, the next time that happens, the tribulation has entered. And when the tribulation has entered, that can only mean that the rapture has happened. That means the Lord is saying, be careful now. The wedding of the Lamb is about to take place. So you need to prepare. There's not much time. And I want to end up now with this vision here. Before I bring a special message to the youth for you, listen to this. When we were in France, in Paris last week, after I finished the meetings, and I was going to meet the pastors and leave on the 11th of May, that night the Lord spoke to me in a mighty vision. Ha! This is the first time I'm releasing it in Kenya. How blessed is the University of Nairobi? In that vision, I am going to describe it here. I found myself I found myself in that vision walking. I was walking on the road, but there was so much light, and I knew it was coming from above. Everything became glorious. But I was walking, and then the voice said, look and see what has fallen at your feet. Again, walking, and the voice came from above, look and see what has fallen at your feet. But instead of looking at the feet, because the voice came from above in that vision, I remember I looked at where the voice was coming from. And then I saw a piece of paper that was coming like this over the wind, like this, and it fell on my foot. And in that vision, when I picked it, those listening by radio, this is the first time I'm releasing this. And when I picked it and looked at it, I saw that it was handwritten, written by hand, like with an ink pen. And it was written 3 times. And what was in the writing? The first part said, I am coming. The next one under it said, I am coming. The third one, when I looked, said, I am coming. 3 times. 11th of May, we were in Paris, France. And the note fell on my foot in that vision. And when I saw written 3 times by ink pen, I am coming. I am coming. I am coming. The Lord is coming. Precious people, the Lord is coming for the church. When Jesus comes for you, you will never worry again. There will be no hunger again. There will be no fear again. There will be no anxiety again. There will be no poverty again. There will be no saying, look, I am from a poor family again. There will be no fear saying, where will I get my job again? When Jesus comes and finds you ready, joy unspeakable, eternal joy, eternal peace, eternal blessings. 3 times. I am coming. I am coming. I am coming. And I found out that in the last book of the Bible, the last book of the Word of God, the Bible, the last chapter, again, the last book, the book of Revelation, the last chapter, chapter 22, he mentioned 3 times, it's in red, I am coming, I am coming, I am coming. What a wonderful God. Is he saying to the church, that is it, it is done, I am coming. And we have to prepare the way for the Lord. About the science, about the nursing training, the medical training, the Kenya water training, about the law trainings, about everything you train us, sociology, name it, all the wisdom you are acquiring here, there is the coming of the Lord. Even the academic stuff, the coming of the Lord. Let us prepare for him. and share with you that even despite the brilliant, the thrilling academic career, finally wisdom came to me when he called me. That I can now return to you and say, look, above all the wisdom of men, there is the coming of the Messiah. When it's all said and done, when the curtains about the kingdom of the earth is closed, then there is the kingdom of God. Then there is the Messiah. Let us prepare the way for the coming of the Lord. You know that what I'm saying is from him, because you can see, those of you who have been in the meetings, the creepers walk, the deaf ears open, tumors disappear. Look at what just happened in France. They're still in shock in Paris. The tremendous power of God that came down to prove to them that, look, I have sent him here. Prepare the way. Look at the earthquakes in Kenya. Until Kenyans now came to me and said, look, the earthquakes you said, they came, but they were not the big ones we wanted. How can you cry for a big earthquake? How can you ask for a huge earthquake, Kenya? Do you know what it means when an earthquake visits town? Huh? Do you really know what it means for a huge earthquake to visit town? Do you know what it means? He can obliterate the history of the country. You might not even be there to take stock. When God shook you and said, I want to prove to you that he's my prophet, and God tarries, that means he has loved you. Just repent. Just repent and bless him. Kenya, I am coming. I am coming. I am coming. University of Nairobi, even those of you in the halls of residence up there, the Lord is coming. Let us prepare the way of the Lord. Precious people, time is over. He is coming for the church. Hallelujah. I want to share a simple brief before I finish, because we have less than 30 minutes. Listen to this. If you're writing now, write down the following for the youth. One day, if we have time, we can go through them, but you can read through them even alone. Just to the youth of the university, if you will hearken to these principles, oh, blessed are you. The number one principle that will help you is seek first the kingdom of God. If you're writing, seek first the kingdom of God. Which means in everything you are going to do, even when you're choosing your courses, even when you're talking with your friends, the first thing you'll ask, does it present the kingdom of God first? The first thing you'll ask, how does it relate to the kingdom of God? How does it help me reach the kingdom of God? You can read Matthew chapter 6, verses 32 to 33. Again, Matthew chapter 6, verses 32 to 33. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 29. 1 Chronicles chapter 28, verse 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 6 to 16. Again, 1 Corinthians 2, 6 to 16. And then Luke chapter 12, verse 31. The next most important principle that when the youth of this country listening at Moi University now by radio, Egerton University by radio, listening all over Masinde Muliro, the many universities and colleges and KMTCs here. The second most important principle is love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. Love the Lord your heart. Hallelujah, listen to this. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength. Especially the youth, with such tremendous strength you have. If you love the Lord your God with such strength, what tremendous exploits you can do for the kingdom. I'm rushing through. Number three, and you can read the second item, love the Lord your God with all your soul, your heart, your mind, your strength. You can read Deuteronomy chapter 6 verses 1 to 9. And John chapter 14 verses 15 to 21. And you see that Jesus said, whoever loves me obeys my command. That means if you're going to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength, then you have to obey the command Jesus gave us. John chapter 15, you see it there. But in that command, he says, when you obey the command, then he will send you the counselor. Which means that is the gateway for open heavens into the universities. That is the gateway for the anointing of the Holy Spirit to visit the university community. That you love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, your strength, then you pour the Holy Spirit into your lives. Then never will you hunger again. Never will you starve again, fight again. Never will be anxiousness and all that. Number three, precious people. Give the Lord your God your first fruit. Give the Lord your God your first fruit. What is your first fruit? What does that mean? That is your first strength. Young people, that is your first, those are your first efforts. Take time even as you are in the university. Tell the Lord, Lord, look at how many of my colleagues have not been able to come to university. They're not privileged. They're not able to make it. And yet for me, you've loved me. You've shown a predisposition, a tremendous lavishing of love. And I'm here. So give him your first fruit in the university. That means your first effort. Go out, find somebody who doesn't know Jesus. Speak to them about Jesus. Read the scripture. Bring them to Jesus. Convert them. That is your first fruit. But don't say you have arrived in the university and so you are going to run to drink in the bath as your first fruit. Let us keep our first fruit unto the Lord. The next, hallelujah, you can read that in the book of Exodus 34 verses 19 to 22. I am now talking about number four. Don't seek the approval of men, but of God. Listen to me, the students in Moi University tuned in by radio. Listen to me, the students in Egerton tuned in by radio. All the colleges in the Rift Valley and all the universities assembled here at the University of Nairobi. Don't seek the approval of men, but of God. Make sure in everything you do, don't worry about what men say, but worry about what God says. That will help even choose your your friends in university. You might even walk with very few friends. The Bible says that the road that leads to heaven is a narrow road. But you will please God. I am running now. Number five principle for the youth in the universities. Be totally available to the Lord your God. Again, number five. Be totally available to the Lord your God. Can you imagine the youth of this nation? You are the cream of society. You are the cream. The future of Kenya is you, the university students. God has loved you and put you in that place. But listen to this. At this time in your life, you are not yet committed with some five babies, five children. You are not yet committed with running to make sure you work at work, bring money for rent for these five babies. At this time, most of you are single. Most of you youth at this time, at this stage of your life, you are single. So you can be surely available to the Lord at this time before the world catches up with you. You understand this? This is when you can choose to really be available to the Lord. Because time will come when you will want to work for the Lord. But look, you have three kids. One has to go to the hospital. Another one, the teachers are calling you. And at the same time, you have to go to a job. The husband is saying this, or the wife. And yet at this time, you can choose to be totally available to the Lord. You say, it is me, my studies, and the Lord. Hallelujah! Make sure you exploit this phase of your life. Number six principle to the youth in the university. Learn to stand alone. Again, learn to stand alone, even in the church. Learn to stand alone, even in the church. Even in the church. Because many times if you will go to the church, you might even find that there is sexual sin in the youth church. Learn to stand alone, even in the church. Jesus of Nazareth, he learned to stand alone, even in the church. In fact, the church fought him. Look at my life in this country. When the Lord sent me, I'm not telling you when I'm not living. When the Lord sent me in this country, you think it is easy to be prophesying earthquakes and blood flow and telling them I see parts of human bodies and it's happening until now. We recently saw in Karatina, Kirinyaga. The church fought me, they ran out from me because I rebuked sin in the church. Because I told the church, you have sexual sin. I told them you are corrupt. You are preaching the gospel of money. I asked them, how about the poor widows? How about the poor boys looking for jobs in the streets? What about wapi mbego za kuleta kanisani? Doesn't God love them? How about the orphans who don't even have a house or rent? And I learned to stand alone, even in the church. And because of that, now God can use me. Even you. Learn to stand alone, even in the church. If you go to church and find that the youth church At night they are doing kesha with disco lights. They turn off disco, they turn off lights and they put disco lights. Or if you go to the Christian Union and find that on Friday they are so-called movie nights. If you find sexual sin there, learn to stand alone, even in the church. Don't compromise. The next, fellowship with people going in the same direction. The next, fellowship with people going in the same direction. Don't be walking this way and yet your fellowship with the drunkards here, the sexually immoral. That's why the Lord told Israel that the land I'm taking you to, take it over, conquer it, and get rid of those people. Don't let them live with you, because their idol worship will act as a snare, a trap unto you. If you are going to fellowship with people at the university and you are a born again professor, or you are a born again student, then you have to be preaching Jesus to them. The only way you can fellowship with them is to show them this wonderful light. But you cannot be drinking with drunkards. You cannot be mixed with the sin of the world. Make sure you can engage, and you engage in the name of the Lord, and quickly withdraw as the Holy Spirit takes course over their lives, over their lives. Be careful. Walk with people going in the same direction. Number 8, most valuable principle to the youth in this nation, in the university. Always maintain an eternal perspective. The youth listening in Egerton University, even the professors in Egerton, even the lecturers and professors in Moi Referral Hospital, in the Moi University, those tuned in by radio, everywhere listening right now, even here, always maintain an eternal perspective in everything you do. Always maintain an eternal perspective. That means about your eternity. That means the first question you will always ask before you talk, before you pick that ringing phone, before you choose that course, before you do anything, before you take that matatu, is how does this help my eternity? How does this help my eternity? I know many pastors long for you. So when you go to their churches, they say, look, I have 8,000 youth. And then you are dancing in their churches. They say, my church is full. And yet, they cannot help you like this to connect you to the kingdom of God. I have been sent here by God to make sure from today on, you are connected to the kingdom of God Almighty, your creator. Always maintain an eternal perspective before you pick that phone, before you go to that beer drinking Friday, or that socializing with your colleagues on Friday, after the cuts, after the what, after the exams. Ask yourself, how does this help my eternity? If the answer is no, disconnect from that. The next principle, he says, be an example others can follow. Be an example others can follow. Make sure You be an example, others can follow. What is the importance of that? Every time you are raised to that position of being an example others can follow, then inevitably you must be responsible. It will instill responsibility into you. That is the importance of this principle I'm sharing here. Remember, when the first years come, make sure you are an example that they can follow. When the young Christians come, make sure you become an example they can follow. Which means you are going to be the image of Christ. You are going to be the ambassador of Christ. So when they see you, they say, you know what? I want to be like her. All her friends have aborted, at least in their second year. But I'm told she has maintained purity, she has distinction, she has stature, she has honor, she has respect, she has a standing, she is being feared, she is being talked about, she is the image here, everyone refers to her. I want to be like her. Be an example others can follow. Even if you have aborted, you can always repent and be restored by God to be an example others can follow. That is the goodness of our God. Our God is a God of a second chance. That's why he sent me to the church, to everywhere, for repentance. Repent and come back. Now you can come back, repent. The next principle. Diligently serve the Lord your God. Diligently serve the Lord your God. Again, I repeat, diligently serve the Lord your God. Which means you should serve him with diligence. What does that mean? That means you should be good stewards of the word of God. In the book of 2 Philippians, I think it's chapter 2, he says, work out your faith in fear and trembling. Diligently serve your Lord, serve the Lord your God in fear and trembling. Diligently serve him, the Lord your God, in fear and trembling, please. With me, before you serve him, say, Lord, help me. I want to do it right. I don't want to make mistake. We are going tonight. We are going to evangelize in these first years or second years or whoever, these people in their halls of residence. But Lord, help me to do it right tonight. That is the fear of the Lord in the university. Serve the Lord your God diligently. The next principle, the last one, precious people. Let Jesus of Nazareth be the perfect example. Be the perfect example of singular focus. Of singular focus on God the Father. Let Jesus of Nazareth be the perfect example of singular focus on God the Father in your life. That means by looking at the life of Jesus, by looking at how Jesus of Nazareth, he was singularly focused on God the Father. Every time he said, I have come to do the works of him who has sent me. Every time he came, he said, I have been sent by him. Every time he said, I don't speak my own words except the ones of him who sent me. Every time, serving God, serving God, serving God, serving God, and serving God the Father. Make sure in everything you do, let your primary focus be service unto the Lord your God. Let Jesus be your perfect example. He even did not allow distractions to pull him from that focus. Precious people, I bless the Lord who have allowed me to share with you this revelation of God on the coming of the Messiah. You can stand up on your feet now as our time is about to end. Listen to me, wherever you are, even the halls of residence, even those standing out there on the stairs, everywhere, I am going to leave this place in the next 3 or 4 minutes. But right now, I am going to give you the greatest opportunity that can ever exist under heaven, above heaven, under the earth, above everywhere. If you know that in your life you have not walked right, today I know He has sent me here. But tomorrow I don't know. As a matter of fact, tomorrow we are Southern Africa down. But today, the door is open here. If you know that you are not well with the Lord, this is the moment to come forward here. I'm going to pray for you in less than 2 minutes. In light numbers, very fast. Hurry, because I'm going. Let everybody come out and receive the Lord. Thank you, my daughter. Thank you so much, my daughter. Thank you. The wise ones are coming to the Lord. No more AIDS will touch them. No more disease will touch them. The wise ones are coming to the Lord. Somebody clap for them. Those who have received wisdom are coming. The day belongs to them. Look at the intelligent ones. The kingdom of God belongs to them. Even those listening by radio, even those in Moi Refro Hospital, even those in Egerton, even you can move closer to your radio. Even look at how everybody is coming to the Lord. Look at how everybody is coming to the Lord. My daughters don't remain. My daughters don't be left out. My sons, the moment has come to defeat the wickedness of the world. The moment has arrived. Make sure no enemy touch you. The moment has come for you to be wise, for you to return to the fear of the Lord. He will provide for you. He said, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and everything else He will give you as a bonus. Look at how they are coming. My daughters, don't remain. My daughters, look at you running. Run, thank you for running to Jesus. The one in the red t-shirt. My daughter, run to Jesus. Thank you, she's coming, let her shout. Everybody's coming to Jesus. Time is over. You are the future of Kenya. And with Jesus, there is a future for every one of you. He is no man that he can lie. His head is not short. He has a long outstretched arm. Look at how they are coming. Kele kele kwa Yesu. My sons, look at how they are coming from the stairs up, from the halls of residence. Come to Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you for coming. I'm waiting for you. Thank you so much, my son. Thank you so much. Thank you. Just come forward. Somebody let him come through. Let him in where I am in front of me here. This is the biggest revival on the earth. That the centers of excellence, the higher institutions of learning, can return to Jesus. That's the biggest revival. I am going to pray now.